Today we're going to be talking about the affordances that being a Spanish-speaking dev and being in the Spanish-speaking market gives you or takes away from you. And so today we have really a different or a diverse set of nationalities and a diverse set of backgrounds here to talk about that. So first off, I'm going to introduce Jeb Alvarado, who's over there. Jeb is actually from Puerto Rico. I'm introducing each of them, but they will speak. There you go. Jeb's from Puerto Rico, and he was a dev there for a while. He was also the founder of the local IGDA chapter, one of them. And then he moved to New York to be a part of a Escape the Room development company. So that's pretty interesting. He came here to do more of that analog kind of game design. Then we have Elaine Gomez. Elaine is currently a grad student over at USC. She's developing her game called The Sound of Separation. And Elaine's from Puerto Rico too, so we have two Puerto Ricans here. yes, Puerto Rico. But she's gonna be talking more from the point of view of what it's like to be in academia here and trying to bring her cultural background into her games in academia. And in general into social justice too, which is something that she's interested in. Then we have Edgar Serrano. Edgar's from Mexico. He co-founded the game development company Lienzo, and he developed a game called Mulaca. It's in development still. Mulaca, the interesting thing about it is that it's co-created with local indigenous populations. So there's that, you know, part of how do you co-create something in that cultural sense with indigenous populations in Latin America. And then we have David Canela. He's from Tequila Works, which is a pretty awesome game development company in Spain.
Thank you.
yeah, it is pretty awesome. And he has worked for 7 years as a game designer and in several other roles. And in several other companies in Spain, and the interesting thing about Spain is that their history with video game development goes back to the 80s. But most people don't actually know about that, which is really interesting. So we have kind of Spanish-speaking Hispanic, a Hispanic set of people here. And I'm from Costa Rica, which has barely any game development, but it has some. So we're gonna be talking about that too, what it feels to be isolated in that way. And so the first question for you guys, we're gonna be talking over each other, maybe it's more like a discussion kind of thing. The first question for you guys is, what do you think has been the most visible or the biggest challenge as a Hispanic speaker when it comes to game development? It could be in your own countries, or it could be dealing with American gamers or American game designers with your background, right? So I don't know if any of you guys would like to pick up on that.
Can everybody hear me? Yes? I can't hear it, so I'm sorry. Okay. So I think one of the biggest challenges has been figuring shit out on my own, I suppose. because as a Spanish-speaking developer, you get to notice that everything game development or technology related is in English. So we kind of have to learn that English before learning how to develop games. So I'm guessing that that's like the starting challenge when you develop games in a Spanish-speaking country, I suppose.
Yeah. Has that in any way affected your access to knowledge, you know, beyond just the written stuff, but also meeting people?
Well, I know that I had to do a lot of Google University in order to to start. And by posting it on Facebook between my circle of friends, then like learning about LinkedIn and other like professional networks, then you get to meet different people that sort of speak your language, and then you start like networking, right? But I believe that was the one of the biggest challenges. It's just like starting the journey itself, I suppose.
In Spain, we have some kind of problem with our own culture, is that we don't defend it.
So we have no problem in adopting others' ones. So, for example, with Deadlight, that was based in Seattle, I suppose nobody had any problem in taking information about there or learning the different things of America's 80s. So we really don't have those kind of problems. But instead in Rhyme, we are defending a lot the visual style from Sorolla, that is Spanish painter. And in that point, we defend that visual style, but we are not close to other things. I mean, we want to do a game that's reachable for everyone. We don't want really to be close to a certain audience because of cultural barriers, really. And well, even in Spain, it's now pretty globalized. We cannot say that we have very or too many specific things like toros or sevillanas. No, that's only a well. Nobody usually does those things in their day-to-day. So we usually don't have problems.
Right.
Well, in my case, that came as a benefit because the game that we're making, Mulaka, it's as we said before, a game based on Rarámuri culture, which is indigenous tribe, and people who are not from Mexico, even because I don't know why Mexicans hate their own culture in that sense, but people who are not from there really admire that stuff. Like we get a lot of attention from Americans, we get a lot of attention from Japanese people, from European people, who maybe think of touring that part of Chihuahua because it's really touristy, the part where they live in. And so that comes as a benefit to us if we show off this type of side of our culture, which most people don't know, because I guess they see it as a genuine kind of hero environment or hero story or whatever that really exists, which I'm sure if you can find something cool with Apaches or Vikings or samurais and stuff, then there's a universal appeal to that. And once you start liking that type of stuff, then you get into the culture itself. So once you're into samurais, then you're probably not that hard to transfer into manga and stuff like that. And for us, maybe that's the appeal that other people find for us. Like maybe they're a little bit into Mexico and they now know that there's this other side of Mexico which is prehistoric and awesome, and it's not only Mel Gibson's Apocalypto movie. Like there's a lot of other stuff out there in Mexico, but it's in the same vein. Like all of these cool cultures who hunted in an extraordinary way and all of that stuff. So I mean, in that aspect, we have a real good time with that. And with the language barrier, we're making the game with authentic Rarámuri narration, so it's easier-ish to put out the version in Spanish and in English, but you definitely have to put it out in both languages. I mean, you cannot just go, okay, Spanish or okay, English. And I think that's better for people who don't have any dialogue and stuff in their games, which can be really cool because there's no barrier at all. And that's what we're trying to make or achieve.
Yeah, I think that also maybe because in Puerto Rico, English is like a second language too, even though it's not like strictly enforced in the public education system. I think that developing games in English help kill two birds with one stone versus developing in Spanish makes us believe that we are limiting ourselves to a specific audience and we will not be as successful because it's only being developed for a certain audience. But I'm guessing that we're not paying attention to the numbers of how many people speak Spanish and will understand that. And like because of that, we may be a little ambitious and try to focus on developing for people in the States. And yeah, I think that because of that ambition, it's what like makes us want to develop. Plus, like growing up with all these AAA games, Like, since we were kids, they're all in English. Everything is like very beautiful. Everything is like, oh my God, this is great and this is successful. Therefore, this is the way to go. So, like, not having as many examples in Spanish, not having as many references when we grew up, may have been like a big factor for us to want to develop in English, where maybe we don't realize that maybe we are the generation that are supposed to create that Spanish bed for those who are growing up, are able to grow up with Spanish games, you know?
I don't know how elitist it is, but it may be realist as well to think that if you're someplace where it's Spanish-speaking country and you're into games, then you're probably into English as well.
Yeah.
Like, it's really hard to find somebody who is really into games, and I mean that he gets into the story and all of that, and he doesn't speak English, because then it's impossible. And, like, I grew up like that. My English, my education, it's partly because of games. I had to learn the language to be able to figure out how to defeat this guy or get that item. And personally, because of that, now whenever I see a game that's made in English and I see the translation, I hate it. Mm-hmm. Like, when I downloaded StarCraft, since I was in Mexico, I got the Spanish audio and everything like that, and it's awful. It's really bad. And maybe that's bad in my part because I'm a Mexican and I should be gravitating towards Spanish-speaking things. But for me, games in English, they just feel more genuine. I don't know why. And maybe that's part of my culture that it kind of hates itself, I guess. But for me, at least, in my upbringing, games are usually like in line with English almost always.
I think it has to do with localization, like a lot. It has a lot to do with localization because if they're being primarily developed in English, when you translate them, it's like translating something in Google Translate. It'll be awful by default, and you need to check. So it's like translating a sentence from a language to another may be hard. So like putting into a scope of a game where like a lot of culture goes into that specific game, try to make that culture of the game understandable for the different audiences that, in this case, let's say Spanish, for it to feel natural is very hard.
Yeah.
And that's why, like, I also, when the game primary language is in English, I will play it in English because that's the way to go. That's how it's originally made. Versus if I see something developed, usually Flash games or web browser games are being developed in Spanish, then like if they're in Spanish, then I'm gonna enjoy them because I know that there's a Spanish speaking developer behind it, so it's I know that the intentions are there, and it's pretty neat.
I think that in Spain, it is totally the opposite.
Oh really?
I think it's because of our natural barriers. No, we have France on top, mm-hmm. and Portugal, and we don't speak English so often. And well, when I was little, I have people that study with me and has no idea of English. Mm-hmm. And they played games, and they just played and didn't read, no, for example. But also, we have a quite good culture of localization. Mm-hmm. And I think, the translation in Spain is pretty good. Also, there are always mistakes mm-hmm. and things, but all the movies come localized and all that. Mm-hmm. So we are really not so used to using English. And it's more or less the opposite, as you were talking.
Just one little point. It's just that in games, like, we have to quantify, right? Because it's what games are. It's we program them, right? But languages are these beautiful, complicated, ancient, we speak them, right? And how can you quantify idioms and phrases and these very complicated ways of communication, right? So it's just like in Puerto Rico, we have these phrases that they're so hard to translate into English. So it's just like, how are you going to translate them into English or into French, into Portuguese, or even into somebody who speaks Spanish in Mexico that who may not understand that Spanish dialect is maybe different. Like we say corn maíz, they may say elote. You know, it's like even the words are different. Yeah. So it's just like, how can you try to simplify something into a very basic form? It's not that easy.
I think that's another point why developing games in Spanish. So I think that's another point why developing games in Spanish is such a difficult thing, because we have Mexican Spanish, we have Puerto Rican Spanish, we have Spain. We have in every country there's a different
the dialects.
Yeah. So how can I make sure that I'm not offending anyone when I'm using certain words, or like how can I make sure that the words I'm using are being understood by everyone? Mm-hmm. Where I know when I'm doing it in English, everyone will understand it. Mm-hmm. So it's
I wanted to go back for a moment, because David said something that I think is very interesting. When you talked about localization in Spain, a lot historically of this localization was even illegal, from the point of view that it was just like modifying the games yourself. And I think this is actually pretty prevalent in all of Latin America. We grew up with piracy. It's what we did, and even proudly so at times. And so that leads to a complex relationship with game development once you become a game developer. And you're like, wait, but if it wasn't for all of this piracy, I wouldn't even have played games. So I guess I just wanted to explore that a little bit more, and what you think is the relationship of our markets with piracy and how you see that evolving.
I think piracy is the best guide to become a game designer. I probably wouldn't have played so many games and learned so many from them if it wasn't for piracy. Now I buy every game I have, so I have money, I can afford it. But it's in Spain, it's pretty complex. There's the idea that Spanish is the pirates of Europe, no? So at least in video or movies and video games. But little by little, that's changing. Right now, I think they said that people buy more video games than they go to the cinema or buy movies, so they spend more money on that. And I think that also in the past, video games culture was not very established in Spain. I didn't know I was going to work as a video game designer. I didn't know who were that people that made video games. I didn't know anything or where they came from when I was little. Mm. And I think now that it's more culturally accepted, I think people tend to have a bit more of the idea that you need to pay so people can continue making them. No. But 10 years ago, video games in Spain were that thing that creates potential assassins. I don't think it's true, but everybody was afraid of that, no? If you play role games or play video games, you are a psychopath at some point.
In my case as well, I grew up with piracy all the way, and I think that the main deal is that I couldn't put a face to the game because there wasn't much indie community games over there. So wherever I pirated my PS2 games or my Xbox game, I was kind of sticking it to the man, because it's this big, huge company. It's not gonna take damage from me just pirating one game. And that's the small mindfulness that I had back there. And now, when I enter this indie dev universe, I'm like, oh, okay, I know the guy. I saw the guy. I'm not gonna pirate his game. Or you kind of doubt it? Maybe you pirate it all. I mean, at the end of the day, because you just want to play it. But now that you have put a face to it, there's you double take, and you kind of doubt it a little bit, because I mean, you have seen the guy's face. You don't want to screw him as much. And for example, So if I go to a fair or an event and I see the guys And I know that they did it, not just the representatives of, I don't know, Nintendo or Sony. I hope there's nobody here from them. But if you see him, then you even think of, oh, you know what, I'm going to buy it, even though I may not want to play it per se instead of other games. I'm going to buy it because I saw the guy. And I think that putting a face to the game, it benefits a lot, at least in Mexican culture. And also, if I know that a game is from Mexico, I'll go out of my way to get it. Yeah. I don't know why, but maybe it's because it's really rare. Like Kerbal Aerospace game, that's from a Mexican dude. Exactly, yeah, that one. And I didn't know until a few weeks ago, and I'm like, oh, wait, I've seen that before, and I never knew that he was Mexican, you know? But now that I know, I'm going to go out of my way to get it. And now that I met the dude, it's like, okay, I'm never gonna pirate this. And if I tell my friends, like before, I would even give them the crack. Okay, here, play this. This is really cool. But now, if I met the guy, I'm gonna be like a poster boy for it, not piracy in that way. But honestly, for AAA games, I will probably still keep pirating it, really, at the end of the day, yeah.
Exactly. So basically, don't want us to pirate your games, come meet us. That's the message that we're trying to say.
And yet, that's very interesting because we talked about, at some point when we met, we talked about how there are many companies that don't mention that they're from Latin America, precisely because that way you can sell more, right? And this is happening around the world. If you look at several Japanese companies that work as, you know, freelancers for bigger studios, they prefer, this is also a cultural thing, but they prefer not to say where they're from because that way they can just contribute to the bigger brand. And in Latin America, that happens a lot. We have a lot of studios that do freelance, small, outsourced stuff for American companies. So what do you see as pros and cons of saying where you're from? Do you guys you know, put that out there, or do you try to keep it as like, no, we make games for everyone?
I really think people don't know exactly where games come from. Again, for example, I have no problem saying I'm Spanish and we are developing Rhyme or whatever. And a lot of times people come and say, oh, that game is Spanish. It's like another Spanish game pretty famous was Castlevania Lords of Shadows. There's little people outside Spain that knows that that game has been developed in Spain. And, well, it's just, you have the box, you read the back, if you like it, you buy it, and you don't care what it has been made. But I don't think it's really a problem to say it. Just say it, because people will get surprised of where that game comes from.
Yeah, I agree. I've never heard a problem, actually, with somebody saying that they're from such and such country, and they're a Polish studio, they're a Guatemalan studio, they're a Canadian studio. I never heard a problem. In fact, people say they're surprised, like, oh man, they're a Polish studio? That's really freaking cool. Like, that's awesome. Like, I never heard any negativity surrounding that. In fact, it's a surprise. It should be a point of pride. You should be very proud of where you come from, where your roots are from. You should be very proud of who you are. Like, I have a Puerto Rican flag at my desk. Like, my classmates know, like, I went to Puerto Rico recently and I brought a flag and it's like right on my desk. Like, it's just very, very much a point of pride for me.
Yeah, I think it's tricky. Like, if you're, in my case, if you're in Mexico and you go to a meeting, like a business meeting for a potential investor, and you present yourself as a representative of another studio, or you even say we're working with people from a big country, they take you more seriously because you're from outside. But if you're outside of Mexico and you mention it, you get woos and you get claps, like at the beginning of this talk, like Puerto Rico, and then you guys go crazy because Puerto Rico, why not? And that's the same thing if you're in China or if you're in anywhere else and you spot another Latin American, you go crazy again and you go hugging and whatever. Because you get that sense of, this is rare. Yeah, if you are from LA, and you're from a LA studio, and you tell people, oh, I did it in LA, well, yeah, you and another 1,000 things, right? It's not that rare. But since we are kind of rare-ish, maybe, that gets more of a, oh, okay, that's weird to hear. That's why you say it. that's the tricky part. So you say it when you're maybe outside of Mexico, which is weird. Inside of Mexico, maybe you want to show off more if you're in league with other type of advisors. For example, in my example, when I go to investors, I have to put it right front and center. I'm working with people from Carnegie. I'm working with people from New York. I'm working with people, so blah, blah, blah. So they get that sense of, oh, okay, he's not just like here, okay? Because they see a value in that. I don't know why. But you have to do that if you want to get taken seriously. But outside of that, yeah, sure, I'll scream it to the four winds. I'm from Mexico. So, yeah.
I asked a couple of friends back home about why do they develop their games for the audiences that they do. And I noticed that a common thing between their answers was that they really don't care. Like, they just want to put the game out there. They want to develop for everyone. And it's all about just putting the game out there. I don't think that we're afraid to say that we're from Puerto Rico, let's say. But I also believe that we would have a better response if we say, we're from Puerto Rico, but we also have a background in working with X studio in the States or this other studio in the States. And that way, like, if I go back home and tell them, hey, I worked in this studio in the States, everyone's gonna be like, wow, really? Wow, you must be a great developer. Even if I was the janitor for that studio, like, you must be like the best developer because you worked there. And they don't even do a background check or anything. It's just, I wanna say it's a Puerto Rican thing, like making the States the big idol. Where everything is successful, the American dream, yeah. I suppose. I've seen people in Puerto Rico not being shy about their heritage, and when they put their games out there, they just want to promote the game. They just want the game to be successful. They're not focused on you should buy this because you're Puerto Rican. Mm-hmm. You should buy this because the game is good. Mm-hmm. So like it, mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think another issue there is when we make games, usually we tend to go in the directions of the things we like. And we have all been raised with games from America or Japan. And I think we tend to replicate that. We are not thinking really in our root, just what we lived and what we liked of our lives. And for me, it was a lot of Japanese games, for example. And if I could decide what type of game to do, probably without knowing it, I will do something that looks more like a Japanese game than a Spanish or American one.
I think we first need to learn how to make games before making our games. So like that, those first prototypes, those first games that go out there are mostly about different things or different clones from major games. And after a while, you will see like different cultural games starting to pop out and getting that attention. But in the beginning, it's about learning how to make the game itself. So, yeah.
Do you guys see any examples of efforts toward making our games? What would our games look like to you guys?
I know that there's the first game that I saw in Puerto Rico being like announced as a Puerto Rican game in the media was called Tripleteo, which is a game about making tripletas, which are like sandwiches with three meats.
They're amazing.
Yeah.
And really bad for you.
Yeah, it's a Puerto Rican thing, I suppose. But yeah, it's a game about making sandwiches, and it's like a memory game. You will have a customer, he will ask you, I want one with chicken, tomato, and lettuce, and you need to remember chicken, tomato, and lettuce and send it out. And it was a casual mobile game. And it was very made for Puerto Rico. And I think that because the team that made it That was their first project, and they did they didn't have any business experience, any marketing experience. They didn't promote it as much, but they did get lucky because the media caught it, mm-hmm. and it was promoted locally. But that lasted like for weeks, and then the game died, you know? But like we were very proud of that game because it was our game. Like it felt very ours. So I think that they did a good job with that, like game-wise, like making it cultural.
For me, the first game I saw that got me into making games was this. It's awful, but it's a game from, it's called Triple A, it's three A's, which is a game of Mexican lucha libre. That's wrestling. It's not wrestling, it's lucha libre. It's different.
It's
yeah,
very different.
Obviously. The game itself sucks, and it did really badly, but it was right there next to other Triple A games, and it was awesome. Like, at that time, I was making board games with buddies of mine, and when I saw that, I'm like, oh my God, this is possible. This is actually doable. Like, you can really make games about Mexico or in Mexico and make it. And there's this other game, which also sucks, called Chavo del Ocho Kart, which is which is like Mario Kart, but done badly. And about Chavo del Ocho, and it's done by the same company. They don't seem to catch a break. But again, yeah, it sucks. Yeah, it's a bad game, but it's right there. Like, it's up there, you know? Mm-hmm. So if a game that's bad and it sucks made it, why isn't mine going to make it if it's good and if it's actually playable and stuff like that? And then you get really good games like Hartford Alicia, which is a guy from Monterrey. And that did awesomely on Kickstarter, and the game's awesome, and it's beautiful, and it's not about Mexico at all. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't show itself as a game from Mexico. And when you find out, you're like, oh, okay, maybe it's like actually possible to make games like that. So when you speak about Mexican indies, you talk a lot about that, and you also talk a lot about, there's a lot of studios that have Mexican guys working for them. They just came over here because there's more opportunities here. But like the talent, it's always been there. It just comes here because you guys pay better. And I mean, I don't think I have to prove that Mexico is a good indie dev or Mexico is a good dev, because there's examples everywhere. I don't think it's exclusive to a country at all. That's retard to think about. And like, you have to be able, but you have to be able to have those examples, you know? As bad as it may be, you have to be able to like go back and say, oh yeah, but I saw this, and it was there. I mean, I didn't dream it, and I saw the review got a 2 out of 5 or whatever. I mean, it does exist, and you can make it.
So we're gonna go into one last topic, and then you can ask us questions. But speaking of developers that come into America to get well paid to begin with, which is interesting because if you think about it, people in here are just trying to get paid too. Jeb, you actually went from Puerto Rico to New York, and I was wondering if you could perhaps expand upon the differences in the way that people in Puerto Rico work with each other and what you see as pros and cons of working in Puerto Rico with other devs versus being in New York, pros and cons too. So I don't know if you could talk a little bit about that.
I think that when we move out of our country, we don't want to get out of our country. We just want to gain that experience to bring it back. And I think it's very important to just take it slowly and learn every aspect of it. Right now, I'm working developing escape games, which are real life games, analog games. So it's very different from developing digital games. And I've been learning a lot of from the experience of my bosses, which have been developing these games for a while now. And it's very interesting how, like, when I pitch in, like, hey, I'm thinking about this puzzle for the room. And they're like, no, that's not gonna work. And I'm like, how do you know? and they're like, okay, so let's run it by me. And I explain the puzzle. And they're like, okay, so this is gonna happen, and this is flawed, and this is flawed, and this is flawed, and that's why, like, I told you it's not gonna work. Versus, like, developing them back home where we're all figuring it out. We don't have mentors. We're just everyone sort of in the same level of development, yeah, expertise. It's like, well, that idea sounds amazing. Let's do it. And we do it. We waste our time. We waste some efforts and resources, and then we realize that it's not gonna work. So, like, I think that one of the major things that I enjoy about being here is not falling as much. Like, I'm learning from the ones who already fell. And that's sort of why I came here. So it's for me, it's very interesting as a developer, because it's like a very huge learning experience. And I mentioned to Edgar earlier, I love learning. So this is like, I'm in paradise right now because of that.
I don't know if any of you guys.
Myself, I went to this trip, this business trip, I guess you could call it, to Silicon Valley, like 2 months ago, and I came back to Mexico convinced that I had to move. Like, okay, if I want to make it, I really have to move. At least one of us from the studio has to be here and just to hustle, I guess it's the right term. And then I got into the prices, and then I thought I'm not going to move at all, because it's really, really expensive to live in San Francisco area. But again, as soon as I started traveling to different expos and to different things, like, your perspective just gets blown away out of proportion. Like, you guys worry about your game being diverse and not offending anyone from LGBT and having that taken care of. We would never think about that at all, because we're first thinking about making it, and then we can worry about all that stuff. It's just one example of a lot of things you never even think of when you're over there, and you have to take those stuff into consideration. But you will never see it when you're there. It's funny, because when I started this out, I thought that it wouldn't be a problem because it's all online, and I can just, like, it's online and then it's for everyone. But no, I mean, you actually have to put yourself out there. Maybe not necessarily move, but you have to be constantly present at this type of stuff and talking to people and being talked to. And so that's why now what we're trying to do is get in touch with people that know and that are willing and able to tell us what to do and what not to do, but long distance, because it's really expensive to have it in person. So yeah, I think you have to definitely get yourself out there and, like, try to absorb as much as from the other ones. And if you're gonna make a mistake, make it fast, yeah, so you can recuperate easily and non-expensively, I guess.
It's like that term called fail faster.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because if you see, like, even here in the States, some of the most successful independent studios are people that work for AAA with years of experience, like a long background of experience and expertise, and they just decide to do their own thing, and they already have that, like, all that experience. We don't. So we need to gather as much experience as we can, and, like, there are issues that rise from those that already know that we like Edgar just mentioned, we really don't think about them. Mm.
But I also think, this is not a question, but I also think that there's an interesting kind of, like, coalition of working for audiences that are not our own, and then absorbing professional knowledge that is not our own, and then growing up with games that are not our own. And so even though we do need this mentorship, I think there is inherent value in how we are falling on our faces on our own. And, you know, that's hard to balance, but I think there's there are interesting cases, like for example, Spain, they fell flat on their faces in different ways than American audiences, right? I mean, American developers. And sadly, though, there was like a games crisis also in Spain, right, during the 80s too,
the
I guess?
80s. It was the golden age of game development in Spain. Well, golden age, two people in a garage making
but making a lot of games, right?
Make a lot, yes.
Right. There is a different knowledge that we can be creating by falling flat on our faces too. So I guess there's what I mean to say by that is that there's also value that maybe we can't see and we haven't leveraged in the way we don't know what we're doing. And maybe Americans don't know either, but we think they do, right? So there's inherent value in that. And with that said, we're gonna open this up for maybe like two questions, one question. if anyone has a question, if not, we will continue speaking. But yeah. Questions? No. Okay. I think I should go with my microphone. And not fall.
So what companies do you think have done really well in localization? Like, it's interesting that you mentioned StarCraft II as your example of like a really bad Spanish localization, because they spent millions of dollars on their entire localization team. Like, they re-render cinematics in languages, and they're the only company I can name that does that. So like what would be like a good example of a company that's reaching out to people more than just a translation?
Well, I don't know. I cannot think of one, honestly. It's just that there's a lot of, like Elaine said, there's a lot of nuances that you only get if you speak Mexican, not Spanish, Mexican. And there's a lot of nuances that you get if you only speak Puerto Rican. So for example, if I wanted to make a comedy game or a game with some humor in it, it would never translate, ever, even to Puerto Ricans. I don't think it's impossible. I mean, yeah, I think there's, like, for example, in Spain, everything is translated, and for them, it's not a problem at all.
Sometimes.
Oh, okay, sorry.
remember, you have played Monkey Island 2? There is a part when you have to hypnotize a monkey to use it as a monkey wrench. No? It's called like that. Okay, in Spanish, it's that direct translation should be English key, llave inglesa. And I had no fucking idea what to do in that puzzle because it was that localization puzzle, no? In some way. So it's not always possible to translate things.
The easiest way I can try to explain it is with film. So in film, we have subtitles so that we can read, right? So if I'm watching a Spanish film, you have English subtitles. Sometimes even what is being said in Spanish doesn't exactly translate in English, but you can, with visual expression, tell what's kind of going on. So I think sometimes that is what games have to do. You have to visually explain to the player what is happening. So either by environmental, like something going on in the environment, whether that the player's avatar's expression, whether that be visual feedback, tactile feedback, something, some type of feedback has to happen other than just with auditory cue. You know, and I think that we're going somewhere with that. I think that we cannot rely any longer just on narrative and words. I think that we are understanding that now in game development, that we cannot rely on words, just words anymore.
Oh, sorry. I just thought, like, The Sims is actually, it translates good because of the emoticons or emojis or whatever you want to call it, because that's universal.
Yeah.
At all.
Yeah, yeah.
So if you do that, then everybody's going to get it. And the best thing, which I love, is that they have this gibberish, you know, this sim gibberish.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, you make of it what you will.
Yeah, yeah.
If you're American, you're going to make that dialogue, you're going to translate it in your head as an American idioms and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
If you're Mexican, you're going to make it Mexican because you see the emojis and you see the guy thrusting or whatever, and then you think of piropos, right, or whatever. cat calling, sorry. So I think that's a good example. Like, they rely on something that's universal, which is body language and emojis like that. And also, like Elaine said, like, for example, Limbo, the mobile game, which is beautiful, that also I think translates a lot, because sadness and loneliness, that's universal too. I mean, you cannot really, and there's no way to make it better by adding language. You just have to like show it raw. And I think that's a good thing. But for example, for StarCraft, it's difficult because they created this whole universe and there's this whole thing. And there's even comments and idioms that all are exclusive to the Star Wars universe. I mean, sorry, the StarCraft universe, not to an idiom per se. So, I mean, if you talk about Zergs and stuff, you understand like their way of living. And it's not because you're an English speaker, it's because you're a StarCraft player.
Any other questions?
It feels really interesting because I come from Taiwan and I speak Chinese. And it's really interesting because although I don't know any of you, but everything you said is like 99% similar to what I know and what I feel. And I don't know how many non-native English speaker here. I think you... If you are a native English speaker, you probably feel the same. Like all the like language barriers or the tech or hardware investments is not getting into game investments and language barriers or things just happening. I think you also know read an article about Polish game development. I think a year ago or something, that story is actually pretty identical to we've experienced here. So I guess my question here is that because you come from all the like Spanish, different kind of Spanish speaking world. Also, I want to emphasize this. If you are doing Chinese localizations, please separate the simplified one from the traditional one. Yeah, it's very, very different.
Yeah.
It's very, very different. So the question is, do you see that when you grow up or when you are like trying to get into a more mature game audiences in your countries, do you see that because of you are not the country where, it's like you're not getting firsthand information because a lot of the things are originated from Japan or originated from the US. So like you are information about games is getting picked by some of the medias, and so your game development in knowledge or your market in your countries are like they have narrow visions about what game should be, and does that affect your game development, or does that affect like do you have an indie friendly market in your countries?
Puerto Rico, we don't have like such a great indie market. Mm-hmm. I think that it's a generation thing, mm-hmm. like especially support by the government and such is like from the previous generation, and it's hard to get everyone to understand that, as Edgar, I think, mentioned earlier, this is a way of living. This is not just playing games.
Yeah.
'Cause I'm pretty sure that everyone shares this feeling, but when you start saying you're a game developer, someone will approach you saying, oh, you're a game developer, that's great. My son plays video games all the time.
Yeah.
And so you should meet him. And it's like, yeah, but it, like, driving a car is very different from making a car.
Yeah.
So, not understanding that this is a way of living, mm-hmm. like, only thinking it as a way of entertainment is hard to mm-hmm. grasp that market mm-hmm. targeted for, like, in our case, Puerto Rico.
Yeah.
I don't know if that answered your question.
I think what he's trying to say is like is that depiction of media, like the way that the gaming, like the way that media has depicted, has it affected our view? Is that of how we target the, is that what you're trying to say? How it influences our game, our marketing, the way that we market ourselves? Yeah, like Puerto Rico is very much, it's Americanized, but the mentality is like way different than America, like because of culture, right? And like when I was there, like, yeah, just like Jeb said, like they think it's just entertainment. Like they don't think of engineers like making games. So you're like, oh, gamers, like my 8-year-old son can make a video game. What? No, they can't.
Wait, maybe they can.
Yeah, maybe they can, but obviously not like me. Like, what are you talking about? But it's,
if not,
it's,
let's hire them.
Yeah. But it's hard because like you're thinking yourself of as a professional, but they don't think of you that way. They think of you as like as a player. They think of you as a person that goes to GameStop and buys a game and that's it. And then coming here, then you're like a professional, you're an engineer, you're an artist. And that's a disparity, like it's a weird thing to think of in your head. But I don't know, it doesn't affect me per se, personally. It doesn't affect me.
Yeah, in a personal sense it doesn't, but
yeah,
like when you think about it in a global aspect, it's kind of hurtful. And
yeah. I mean, it kind of sucks if it happens to you in a moment. You know, it offends you at the moment, you know. But like when I'm like at home working or something like that, like there's so many more things going through my head that it just bother me.
I have something to add there from the Costa Rican perspective. So there is definitely media, of course, seeps into your country in different ways, right? And so there is a lot of cloning. Not cloning, but imitating games that have been successful in the past. And there is kind of like a delayed feedback loop, right? If we look at our markets as systems too, yeah, definitely. What comes in, specifically in Costa Rica, is completely delayed. Not necessarily because we don't have access to media, but rather because we just see success after the fact, and we go, oh, that was successful. I should make a Super Meat Boy too. And what ends up happening is that there is no real space for innovation because people are just trying to scrape by, which makes sense, happens in the indie development community. But there's no space for actually kind of like cross-pollinating with other indie developers that are making interesting things because they're so far away. So what ends up happening is like an echo chamber of what's happening outside, but of course that already happened. So what we're making are games that are not going to be anything new, right? And in this video game industry, the new is really important. And another thing that I was going to mention again is that the professionalization of game development has been certainly a cornerstone in getting games to make more money and to get out there and to make the industry more organized, right? And to have like pipelines. And but at the same time, the fact that we're not there yet in countries that are outside of America could also be a space for innovation, right? And I guess, for example, the Mulaka case to me is interesting because it's like, how can you co-create with these people that are not developers? And what comes out of that? We've seen examples of great things like Never Alone, right? Who, I mean, they are game developers, but they pair up with people that are not, and what comes out of that? I think there can be strength in that. And so we got to wrap it up. But thank you everyone for being here. It was really great being here. We're going to be around during games night if anyone wants to talk to us. We'll be falling flat on our faces. Or not, or winning and kicking everyone's ass. But yeah, we'll see you around and thank you so much.